Welcome to another Agora online event. Today it's going to be on how to raise Europe's climate ambition for 2030. For the ones amongst you who do not know Agora Energiewende, we are an independent think tank mainly funded by two foundations. Our focus is to help making the energy transition a success, not just in Germany. We're currently around 50 colleagues working mainly from Berlin, but we also have offices in Brussels and Beijing. At the moment, you should only see me and I can check on my control monitor because I want your utmost attention to make you familiar with the online room. My name is Nicola Bock. I'm head of events at Agora Energiewende and I'm your host today to guide you through this online event. Now, what's going to happen during the next 90 minutes? Welcome housekeeping and a first poll. Will take some 10 to 15 minutes. Then we'll have a presentation for about 40 minutes by Patrick Reichen, Felix Mattes, and Jakob Reichen. Then we have 25 to 30 minutes time for Q&As, and we should be ready by 4 p.m. Before I introduce the panel properly, I would like to inform you how you can interact with us because unfortunately we cannot see you and the only way to get in touch with us is writing either into the chat or into the Q&A window. You should use the chat window primarily for any technical issues, for instance, if you cannot hear us or if the screen is frozen or something like that, you can put that in there. It will not be visible for the rest of the audience, just for the panelists. We will use the chat window to inform you about relevant links and information. I believe my colleague Andreas will already put the link to the presentation, which we have already uploaded on our website, into the chat window. So in case you face problems with your internet connection, you can still follow the presentation there. We also put an email address that you can address any comments or remarks into the chat. The other window you can use is the Q&A window or F&A for Fragen und Antworten if you have the German environment. You should put your content related questions in there. And Andreas, who is going to take care of the Q&A session later on, he will go through them and post them on your behalf at the end of the webinar. They will remain invisible until we pick them and then they will become visible for the entire audience. And last point on housekeeping, we are recording the online event in order to make it available for anyone who cannot attend right now. You see it on the top left of your screen. And now let me call the podium on stage, so to say. I would like to call Patrick Reichen first. He's Executive Director of Agora Energiewende. Hello, Patrick. Then we have Felix Christian Mattes, who is Research Coordinator for Energy and Climate Policy at Öko-Institute. Welcome, Felix. Then Jakob Reichen, Senior Researcher at Öko-Institute. Hello, Jakob. And then also Andreas Graf, who's from the Team Europe of Agora Energiewende. He'll be taking care of the Q&A session at the end of the webinar. And before I hand over to Patrick, we have prepared a poll to get to know you a little better, because at the moment we can only see your names, but no more than that. So let me start the first poll, which you should be able to see on your screen right now. I will read out the questions because not everybody may be able to see them. So which sector are you working in, we would like to know? Is it the energy sector? Is it government regulator? Is it industry manufacturing? Science? Are you working for an NGO or others? And people are voting. I will publish the results at the end. But I will read out the second question we have first to you. On which political level are you most active? Is it international, European, national, regional, or local? And then for our marketing department, so me amongst others, how did you learn about this event? A, the Agora website, B, Agora newsletter info update, C, was it recommended by a colleague, or D, other? And come on, I give you another 5 seconds and then I will finish the vote so we can see the result. Okay, I will finish the poll and publish the results. So we see we have a majority of people from government and regulator, 23%, which equals 20 persons. There are also 23% from other sectors, and then 21% from the energy sector, 18% from NGOs, 9% from industry manufacturing, and 6% from science. And regarding the political level, we have a majority on the European level, no surprise, 45%, which equals 39 persons, followed by national level with 30% and 26 persons. And then 30% working on the international level, 7 on the regional, and 6 on the local level. And most of you found out about this webinar because of the info update. Okay, thank you for that. And with a slight idea about who we are addressing in the audience, Patrick, I now finally hand over to you and make sure.
Yes. Thank you, Nicola. Welcome everybody also from my side. I'm the head of Agora Energiewende. We'll soon be calling ourselves Agora Energy. So this is a good moment to deep dive on those European issues that are currently at stake. Andreas, would you please give us the first slide? So what is it that we're talking about? Next slide. We are in the midst of a decision process which is key to Europe's climate policy. It started last July with the new Commission President Ursula von der Leyen committing herself that she would put forward a comprehensive plan to increase the EU's 2030 target towards minus 55%. We have this presidency of this half year being the German one, and Chancellor Merkel has committed that one of the key priorities of her presidency will be to have a decision done by the end of this year on that higher target. She is now quoting 50 to 55%. We know that's basically just these days the European Parliament has been voting on even higher targets, so around 60% reduction or even more. And we have the European Council conclusions, which have said in July that the updated climate target should be decided by the end of this year. So the process of Europe stepping up its 2030 climate ambition as Europe's contribution to the Paris Agreement is now in its hot moments. We expect the European Commission to put forward their proposal next week, and then the decisions by the Council in October or December at the latest. We have invited Öko-Institut to look together with us what a minus 55% target would mean and how one would actually implement it within the European policy framework. And I'm very much looking forward to present you our key findings within the next hour or so. And next slide. With this, I would like to hand over to those who have done the study. I think Jakob has the word.
Yes, thank you and good afternoon, everybody. We're going to present the study. Some of you might have seen and read it already. I will start with the big picture and the parts on the effort sharing, and then Felix will continue with the impacts on the ETS. Next slide, please. As a quick reminder, the current climate architecture and what we're proposing, so at the moment, the greenhouse gas target is 40% below 1919 emissions. This target includes all international aviation, so all fuel sales basically to aviation, independently of where the airlines, the aircraft go. And our calculations are based on a high ambition of 55%. The current ETS target is 43% below 2005, and we propose 61% in this study. Effort sharing is 30%, and in this study we save 47% to go to the overall target of 55%. Now, these are the greenhouse gas targets, and at the same time, they're energy targets. Also, at the EU level and for your renewable energies, there's a target of 32% of gross final energy consumption in 2030. We did not look into this, but obviously this will need to be adjusted and increased as well to reflect the higher climate ambition. The same goes for the energy efficiency target. The current target is 32.5%. This again will need to be updated. On land use change and forestry, the current system says no net debit from these sectors, but it means no accounted net debit. It's a bit of a complex issue, and we're not going to delve too deeply into this. But again, there's a question, will that change with the new target architecture? And the last issue to be discussed in the process is what happens with international shipping. There we have seen the demand of the European Parliament included in the ETS. It's part of the issues the Commission is looking at as part of the Green Deal. But again, this is not yet reflected in our numbers. Next, please. This circle here is basically the EU 27 emissions in 1990, almost 5 gigatons. And the blue part of the circle is the 55% reduction. The orange one is the remaining emissions in 2030. Next one, please. And this can then be further disputed. So we have a reduction that needs to come from the ETS, apart from the effort sharing. And the last blue wedge is the reduction already achieved between 1990 and 2005. And on the remaining emissions, this is how much the ETS effort sharing and then outgoing international aviation outside of the EU ETS are going to have in 2030 under this proposed architecture. Last one, please. Going one step even further, the ETS target is separated between the stationary and the aviation ETS. The total quantity for the aviation is so small that you can't see it here. And for the effort sharing, when we're doing this study, we group member states into three groups of countries. The low-income member states with a GDP per capita below 60% of the EU average, they, under our proposal, will reduce emissions by 32% in the effort sharing sectors. Then there are the middle-income countries, which are between 60 and 100%. They would do roughly the EU average, 46% reduction versus 2005. And the high-income countries, so all member states with a higher GDP per capita, would in total do a 52% reduction. Next slide, please.
Jakob, before we continue, we would like to make another poll here. So here you see the possible ranges of ETS and non-ETS targets. The minus 55 is our scenario. Now we would like to ask you, what do you expect will be the next target? So where do you expect the European Commission will propose to raise the target? A, minus 50, B, minus 50 to minus 55%, C, minus 55, or D, more than minus 55. And then the same question, where by the end of this year will we eventually agree on? Will it be again or less than minus 50, minus 50? Between minus 50 and minus 55, minus 55 or more than minus 55. Please vote now. Nicola, you can probably see who has.
Yeah, it looks pretty good. 3 more seconds for anyone who hasn't made a decision. I finish and publish the results.
Okay, so most expect the minus 55 to be the proposal by the European Commission. This is what we have been reading in the news lately. And the key question is, where will the result be at the end of this year? There's a tough race here between minus 55 or somewhere between minus 50 and minus 55. Okay, Jakob, now please show us what this would mean.
Okay, so in this graph, you can see the relationship between effort sharing and ETS emission targets. So on the x-axis below, you see the target for the ETS sectors, on the y-axis, the effort sharing emission target. The international aviation outside of the ETS has no targets, so this is in all scenarios the same, unless decisive action is taken for that sector. And the first blue circle, which says existing ETS and FHM legislation. This is basically the 40% NDC, where we're going to end up with the current system based on our greenhouse gas targets, which is 43% for ETS and 30% for aviation. But the energy targets were adopted after the greenhouse gas targets, and the energy targets are actually more ambitious. If they would be, if they will be achieved, or when they will be achieved, plus taking into account the coal phase-out decisions in member states that have decided a coal phase-out, the actual reductions would already be 45% below 1990 for the EU 27. So the first step to going towards 50 is already achieved by the decisions made on EU and national level. We're proposing here 55 case, and you see three circles up there, which would all achieve a total of 55% versus 1990. And the range of these three circles is basically, or between the two extremas, is what we estimated in the vision scenario as the technological and economically feasible range of ways to achieve a 55% target. So having a higher ETS target than 63% would require very significant amounts of, or extreme, what we would consider outside of the possible range of realistic policies and achievable measures. So this is basically, and more details Felix can give on that if there are questions on this. This is the range of possible targets, and we just picked the central case between these two extrema, which is then the 61% target for the ETS and the 47% target for the effort sharing. We have not touched the aviation target because this is a separate issue, but in total, aviation emissions are so small that this does not have a very big impact on the ETS aviation on the total target picture. Next slide, please. So then once we have the effort sharing target, of course, the big question, and maybe the most important to many member states, is what does that mean for the individual member states? And the distribution between the EU-wide effort sharing target on member states has been done based on GDP per capita, where the poorest country, Bulgaria, receives the least reduction commitment, and the richest country, Luxembourg, plus the second richest, always have the highest commitment. And in the current 2020 and 2030 system, there's a 40 percentage point spread between the poorest and the richest country. So for 2030, Bulgaria has to stabilize emissions compared to 2005, whereas Sweden, no, Ireland and Luxembourg need to reduce by 40%. Sweden and Luxembourg. And but if we look at this, what that actually means, this you see on the graph on the right, in 2005, the average per capita emissions in the low-income countries was actually well below the EU average. Today, they're already around the EU average. And looking at the 2030 targets, the effort sharing distribution at the moment actually gives, would lead to the highest per capita emissions in the low-income countries. So looking at that, but also looking at the 2050 target of climate neutrality, where we cannot have a spread between the rich and the poorer countries anymore, because we need to reduce all emissions to the extent possible to have a minimum amount of things required to compensate the remaining emissions. It is clear that the poorer countries also need to reduce emissions more ambitiously than they had to in the past. And so we think and we propose that the spread between the countries needs to be narrowed down to have one consistent set of pathways towards 2050. Next slide, please. And this is basically what we calculated in this distribution. We only have a spread of 30 percentage points. So Bulgaria would have a target of minus 25% and Luxembourg and Ireland of 55%. In addition to the GDP per capita distribution, there were also other points on cost effectiveness and so on. We did not take this into account in the distribution. These are then things that might happen in the council discussions. Now, one of the key elements of the effort sharing decision, also of the Green Deal, is always, has always been the element of solidarity, the distribution of the target based on GDP per capita. And of course, if we reduce the spread between the rich and the poor countries, and Bulgaria suddenly has a very substantive target compared to the current system, we need to find another way to express the solidarity. And two proposals we have there is either both similar to the rules in the ETS, have a modernization fund or some other mechanism where a share of the allowances either coming from all member states or only from the rich member states is auctioned, and then the revenue is used for emission reduction projects in the poorer countries. And of course, outside of the effort sharing system, that could also be done through the general EU budget and the different funds there. Next one, please. So, and another key element of the effort sharing regulation has always been the flexibilities, and half of these flexibilities are around market mechanisms. And at the moment, the system is not really operational, A, because there's no shortage until 2020, but also B, because there's no real market. We only have a few actors and it's very intransparent. There's no central platform. So we have a few proposals on how to strengthen that. And maybe the most important one is to set a price signal, because at the moment, any deals are happening behind closed doors. There's no publication of the closing price. So it's very hard for countries to assess whether it's worth doing buying allowances or doing emission reduction at home. If you want to include the private sector, such a clear price signal would be important. So this could be done through different ways. One would be to have a small share of allowances being auctioned, for example, for such a fund, which would give a price signal, which then could be used, for example, to develop projects with the private sector. Not flexibility at the moment is the LULUCF flexibility. Member states can use a certain amount of net removals, accounted net removals, under the effort sharing decision. This quantity is very limited for good reasons, but if we're going to higher targets, this is obviously something to be looked at, and one option would be to increase this limit. The other option at the moment would be to make it easier to use this limit. There are some restrictions on when you can use it, under which circumstances, and these could be removed or changed so it would be more feasible to use this flexibility. And the third option, and this one is looking towards 2050 again, is to have a separate LULUCF target. At the moment, we only have this no net debit rule, but looking at 2050 to achieve climate neutrality, it will be important to have net removals from the sector. So this could also be started now in 2030 with a moderate net removal target to start this process. And the last flexibility that already exists and could be enhanced is the use of allowances under the ETS. So member states would auction less allowances in the ETS and use these allowances to meet their target under the effort sharing decision. And with this, I hand over to Felix and the ETS.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. As an old dog of the European Union emissions trading system, it's a pleasure to present our analysis on what the consequences of a 55% emission reduction target would mean or would be for the European Union emissions trading system. Only as a reminder, for the EU 27, the EU ETS represents 45% of the total greenhouse gas emissions in 2005. And at this point, it's probably worth mentioning that one of the front-running features of this study is that we have based all analysis for the EU 27. So we have seen a couple of analyses which was still based on the EU 28. And what we have discovered here in the written text of the study and with the modeling is that the Brexit doesn't make life easier for climate policy in Europe, and that also applies to the European Union emissions trading system. So it is all about the EU 27 and all the benefits from fast emission reduction in the ETS for the UK is not longer usable for the remaining 27 EU member states. Having said this, it's obviously that the ETS, although it represents less than half of the total greenhouse gas emissions, will need to deliver a larger share of the additional greenhouse gas emission reduction. So with a view to the year 2030, the 61% emission reduction in the EU ETS compared to 2005 emission levels is 1.2 billion tons of CO2 equivalent, less than in 2005. This is slightly more than the emission reduction in the effort sharing Jakob presented to you a minute before. With regard to the higher climate ambition for the EU ETS, it's obviously that a higher ambition needs a more stringent cap for 2030, that's clear. There are many ways to design or to implement a more stringent caps, and that will be the major focus of my presentation. It also needs to be mentioned and bear in mind that this more stringent cap for 2030 and the trajectory towards 2030 will create also reform needs for other provisions and features of the EU ETS. We need to discuss the market stability reserve. We will have a discussion on the level and the provisions on free allocation, and there's also a separate track will be opened on the revenue distribution. These more detailed reforms of the EU ETS have not been subject to the study we presented here, but this is only a reminder that that is not only about the cap. It's about more the cap, but the cap is the first and probably the most important step. If one goes for an implementation of a more stringent cap and 61% below 2005 emission levels, would mean 805 million EUAs for the year 2030 on an annual basis. And essentially, there are three options to design such more stringent cap. The first is, and in all options, there will be a need to adjust the linear reduction factor. The linear reduction factor stands for the steady contraction of the cap, and traditionally, the main focus of the political debate is on the linear reduction factor. As I will show you in the next slide, in a minute, that the exclusive focus on the linear reduction factor may be misleading, because there are two other elements which have a significant impact on the linear reduction factor, even if you go for the same cap of 805 million EUAs in 2030. The first additional provision is the start year for the linear reduction factor adjustment. So that means it makes a huge difference whether the new linear reduction factor, which is 2.2% at the moment, will start in 2023 or in 2025. And the third option, this is a very technical option, but with a huge leverage in terms of emissions, is the rebasing. Only to remind you that the linear reduction factor and the linear contraction of the cap is based not on the emission in the period from 2008 to 2012, it is based on the cap from 2008 and 2012. And we have seen in this period the economic crisis. And so the starting point for the linear reduction factor is significantly higher than the real emissions as an average for the period from 2008 to 2012. And so to adjust this base level for the application of the linear reduction factor is the third lever to adjust the cap to a more stringent adjustment levels. And with this cap, however you do this, the EU ETS regulated emissions would represent a share of 39% of the total EU 27 greenhouse gas emissions in the year 2030. And that means, and simply from comparing the 45 to the 39% shows that the major share of additional emission reduction will come from the European Union emissions trading system. Next slide, please. These are the results. And essentially, you can see here what the interactions between the rebasing, the start year of the linear reduction factor adjustment, and the linear reduction factor are. And essentially, you can get four messages from this sensitivity analysis. That means depending on the level of rebasing, the linear reduction factor changes around 1 percentage point. That means if we continue to apply the linear reduction factor without any rebasing, then we would end in the range of linear reduction factors which are somewhere around 5%, depending on the start year. If we would adjust the base level for the application of the linear reduction factor to the difference between emissions and the cap for the period 2008 to 2012, this would equal a rebasing of 152 million tons of CO2. And you can see here that the linear reduction factor would be significantly lower, 3.6% if the adjustment would start in 2023, and 4.1% annually if the adjustment would start in 2025. If you would go to the most recent differences between the cap and the emission levels, you would end with a rebasing around 300 million tons of CO2. And again, in this scenario, you would see a linear reduction factor which is somewhere between 2.7 and 2.9 percentage points on an annual basis. So the lesson learned is speaking about a certain linear reduction factor is almost useless if you don't add the information. Number one, is there a certain rebasing foreseen? And number two, from which year the linear reduction factor or the adjusted linear reduction factor should apply? This has also other implications if we go beyond meeting an emission reduction target for a certain year. Because as we all know, the climate problem is about, or the climate challenge is about concentrations, and the proxy for concentrations are cumulative emissions. And therefore it is interesting to have a look on the number of new allowances which are brought to the system from the cap perspective for the period from 2021 to 2030. And what you can see here is that there is a significant difference. Even if you meet the same cap for the year 2030, the cumulative the number of cumulative new allowances would decrease between 7 and 8% by each 150 megatons of CO2 rebasing, and also a much smaller but also a visible difference occurs if you start with the adjustment of the linear reduction factor 2 years earlier. That this would change the cumulative new allowances between 21 and 2030 between 1 and 3%. And that means we should have a careful look and with regard or with a view to the cumulative emissions, rebasing needs to be a major part of the conversation and the discussions and in the end of the day, the decisions on how to adjust the cap, because it is not about, it's not only about the cap, it's also about the cumulative new allowances and therefore the cumulative emissions which would occur for the period from 2021 to 2030. Next slide, please. Another dimension of the debate on the EU ETS, and this is about how flexibility options for the European Union emissions trading system could interfere or in the end as one option also change the architecture of the climate policy in the European Union. And we have discussed in the paper four flexibility options which are somehow related to the EU ETS or to another quantity control system, which is the EU-wide inclusion of whole new sectors. So transform the system to an economy-wide emissions trading system. The second is to provide the flexibility to member states to include new sectors into the EU ETS unilaterally without an EU-wide obligations of this expanded scope. We have discussed two other options: to introduce or to set up a separate emissions trading system for transport and or the building sectors, or an options where a coalition of the progressives, where some member states participate in a separate emissions trading system for transport and or buildings without making this an EU-wide obligations. We have discussed these options in detail, and the most significant outcome of this discussion is there are pros and cons for all of those four options, and all these pros and all these cons are significant. And the final decision and the assessment of the different options that depends essentially on the priorities or the views and core beliefs on essentially three different topics. The first is, how do you see the policy mix for this transformation or this transformative emission reductions, and how do you rate cost efficiency on an emission reduction trajectory which is about carbon neutrality in more or less three decades. There is another dimension. There are significant distributional and competition effects between the member states, between different sectors, and also with regard to the people in the different economies, and depending on how you rate these distributional and competition effects, you come to different results. And the third is it is about the political capital and the administrative efforts and the related vulnerabilities from the political processes, which are important. But you can also have a look on these issues from a compliance perspective, where without any doubt the compliance regime of the EU ETS is much stronger than the usual infringement procedures we have if there is a violation of the treaties. I think this needs to be assessed. This needs to be made transparent, and there needs to be a very transparent and in-depth debate on the core beliefs and their viability and accountability. What we learned from even from the numerical debate is that generic debates on the architecture lead to nowhere, because the consequences in the different dimensions depend strongly from the ambition effort which is set for the EU ETS as it is at the moment, and how far additional or extending the scope, for example, for the EU ETS would go. That means there need to be a specific debate the generic debate on all these four debates leads in the end to nowhere, and therefore, if we have the overarching target for the EU, then we need to have a very rigorous debate on the ETS with a view to the general architecture of EU climate policy, but also on the other dimensions with regard to the market stability reserve, to free allocation, and many, many other aspects. With this, I would hand over again to Patrick, and thank you very much for listening to this analysis on the ETS.
Thank you, Felix. Thank you, Jakob. Let me draw the conclusions that we have taken from this analysis and then open up for the discussion. Next slide here. So, how does one get to minus 55%? In essence, we will need a legislative package that the European Commission is to propose by mid next year that then addresses basically all those elements and sectors that are part of the ETS and that are outside of the ETS as it currently stands. So you see we have had here currently a long analysis on ETS and effort sharing. There are two of the cross-sectoral instruments down here. But of course, energy taxation directive is up for renewal as well. The state aid guidelines are to be discussed, the renewables and the efficiency directive. And then when you look at the sectors themselves, obviously the question is on transport. The CO2 standards for cars will need to be adapted because the current standards are not compatible with the 2030 target. The same applies for the agricultural policy. The farm to fork strategy needs to be put into legislation, the common agricultural policy, in order to get agricultural emissions down. And maybe one more example, the industry. There, in essence, we are facing the challenge that a higher ETS target, a tighter cap there, will lead to higher CO2 prices. So the question of carbon leakage and how to treat industry that is in international competitiveness challenges will be of utmost importance. So we expect the Commission to come up with a package that has both addressing the cross-sectoral instruments and those different sectoral legislation reforms in order to put the target in place. Next slide. But then, of course, it's not all only about the Commission. Member states themselves are then also in responsibility to reduce emissions in the non-ETS sectors in their countries. And we've depicted here a few member states that are really showing what is possible in the transport and in the building sector. Sweden has shown how aggressive policy on buildings can look like. And this is 13 years here. So it is possible with an aggressive policy that starts today to significantly reduce emissions in the non-ETS sectors within the next 10 years down to 2030. And several member states have committed to reduce their emissions by 50, 70, or even more percent within the next 10 years. Next. In essence, a higher European target and a higher price of CO2 also in the non-ETS sectors, it all boils down to not only coal phase out, but also an oil and gas phase out. While the coal phase out debate, I think, is now mainstream, and it's only the question of which ETS price will drive out which power plants at what point in time. But the next big thing will be the phasing out of oil in the transport sector, oil and gas in the building sector, and a number of member states have already put legislation in place to phase it out. First for new building, new heating installations, but then later also for existing ones. Next. So what are our key findings? A minus 55% target is technically and economically feasible. In our central scenario, so not pushing ETS nor non-ETS sectors to their limit, we come up with a minus 47% for the non-ETS sectors, so that is mainly transport, buildings, and agriculture, and minus 61% for an ETS, that is energy and industry. It will require, second, a mix of EU measures and additional domestic measures. So this is the policy mix that is needed on both levels, European and member state level. There are a lot of flexibility options. So a member state that doesn't really see at this point how to deliver a tougher effort sharing target. This is really basically, there is a broad range of options to come forward. And the key element that I think we will be negotiating and discussing when it comes to, I guess, both the ETS and the non-ETS is, what about solidarity? Because if we move towards zero by 2050, then the effort sharing regulation can't be the place where some countries do minus 50% and others only minus 10% greenhouse gas reductions. At the end, all have to be at minus 100%. So essentially, solidarity will then rather be through money, through dedicated funds, through the EU budget. But at the end of the day, the per capita emissions in the non-ETS will need to align, and a minus 55% target more or less means 3 tons of per CO2 per capita in the non-ETS sectors Europe-wide. And that's where we will need to aim with our policies. Thank you. And now I would like to hand over to Andreas. I think the questions that were asked to us should also be addressed now in public and not just in writing.
Yes, thank you, Patrick. So indeed, we have received quite a few questions that the panelists have diligently responded to in writing during the opening presentation. And I would like to take the opportunity first to welcome any further questions from the audience. You have some minutes and would be happy to take additional questions if you should have them. But maybe to just get us kicked off, we did have a question both in terms of the carbon budget we used in determining our analysis or setting the scope of our study, as well as the Paris compatibility of the minus 55% target. And I thought perhaps, Patrick, you could again set the scene for what we plan to achieve with this study and why we chose the minus 55% target.
Yes, thank you, Andreas. So this is not trying to engage in that debate. What is the fair share for Europe? That is a question where a lot of normative issues, north-south equity questions come into place. And that is for the political landscape, and to then at the end come up with an EU target. And I know that there is a discussions it should be minus 60 or even minus 65%, but we had different question that we wanted to answer here. We are basically taking von der Leyen's minus 55% saying we wanted to answer the question, so how does it look like to really implement the minus 55? Because there has been little attention to that question so far. What does it mean in terms of changing in the ETS? What does it mean in terms of effort sharing? The current discussion that I perceive is a lot of member states don't want to touch the effort sharing regulation because it is so difficult to negotiate those effort sharing targets. But looking at the numbers, we come up with the conclusion you have to. You can't just do it via ETS. You have to find an answer how to reduce emissions in transport and buildings and agriculture. And at the end of the day, that includes having a look at the effort sharing regulation. So that was our question. Not abstract targets, but concrete implementation. And it's complicated enough to try to get that implemented.
Thank you, Patrick. And the second question, which was, I think, maybe even the first that was posed during Jakob Greichen's presentation, is one regarding the effort sharing regulation flexibilities. And Jakob already responded to this in writing, but I thought I would pose it again. This is from Femke de Jong. Is there a risk that increasing the effort sharing regulation flexibilities for LULUCF, for ETS, etc., would lead to the EU missing its 2030 nationally determined contribution? Jakob?
This is an issue we already have now. The EU on the international level has set the 2030 target, it's a one-year target. But in our domestic EU internal legislation, we have annual targets where you're allowed to bank, where you're allowed to borrow. So basically, even if we have a cap in the ETS and the effort sharing, this does not mean that the limits are kept at this value for any given year. So even now, it's likely or possible that the 2030 target would not be met because we have such a large surplus in the ETS that the ETS emissions could be much higher than the 2030 target, the current target. So yes, this is a problem the EU has in the different ways the targets are defined, and this might get a bit stronger with higher flexibilities. But on the other hand, there's the update of the NDC, and if the EU would change approach to LULUCF, that would have to be included into the NDC as well. And the ETS effort sharing flexibility, I don't think that would affect this danger of not meeting international target despite being in the meeting the EU internal targets, because this is just moving emissions between two sectors in the EU but not changing emission levels.
It's mainly the banking and the borrowing that do the risk. Yeah.
Thank you, Jakob. And now, Felix, I would like to hand over two questions that I think were inevitable given the reform options and number crunching that you did for this study. Namely, the question anyone working in the ETS sectors wants to know, that wants a business case, or is looking at what a reform would mean for them. What would you expect an increase in the target would mean for the CO2 price on the one hand? And I think I would just add here a second question regarding a minimum price for emissions in the ETS, which is not a reform option that you touched upon in your presentation. Maybe you have some comments or thoughts on this.
Yeah, thank you. And I think the projecting the EU ETS price has been an exercise which has been done many times in the past, and all of these projections have been wrong. However, with this new and least very stringent cap, it is probably a little bit easier than it has been before. Because if you really look into the details, and that comes back to the friction between the normative levels and the inertia from the capital stocks, et cetera, et cetera, 61% emission reduction in the EU ETS would require that coal almost completely leaves the system, and that we would see a significant, significantly higher emission reductions in the industry than before. And if you take the benchmark for what level would be needed that coal leaves the system, then you end up with CO2 price levels, which are somewhere between 45% and 55% euro per ton of CO2, if you assume the recent fuel market environment. That might change, and so any projection for the CO2 price always depends on the spreads between the fuel prices. But again, for the 61%, I would be very confident that if we are successful to eliminate the surplus by the MSR or other mechanisms, then we would probably end somewhere between the 45 and the 55 euro. Due to these uncertainties of the fuel market environments, I think that a minimum price floor, whether a general price floor or a selective price floor, for example, for the power sector, as it has been implemented in the UK in the good old times of the EU 28, is obviously one of the options which will be discussed. And I think we had this debate before, and I still think that either on an EU level, but probably more relevant for a coalition of the progressive, a price floor, at least for the power sector, should be part of the portfolio. But again, this will depend and interfere with the decisions which are made on the MSR and free allocation and others. And that brings me back to the Paris conformity. And I think one of the secrets behind the success of the Paris Agreement is that everybody can interpret the Paris Agreement from different perspectives. There are ones who say that the Paris conformity is about the NDC. Others say it's the 1.5 degree threshold. Others say the 2%. And there are many, many debates from a normative level to break down a global emission budget to certain regions or even countries. The necessary complementary analysis which needs to be done is, number one, how to reflect this type of cumulative emissions and emission reduction targets by the inertia of the capital stocks, and secondly, how to reflect this in the policy mechanisms. And I highlighted this with regard to the rebasing. There are certain reflections, or there are some ways how to reflect the cumulative emissions, also by implementing certain stringency levels for the cap. And I think this is the important debate we have. I'm not entirely sure if we will end with a big consensus what the budget for the EU is in which time frame, but what is important that an important matrix for the reforms is not only meeting a certain annual target or to go for a linear reduction. We should increasingly use the cumulative emissions and the cumulative allowances as one of the metrics we need to have a discussion on.
Thank you, Felix. And since I did receive this challenge to also pose the question on price to Jakob Greichen, I will do so right now. So the question is concerning prices, which I posed to Felix regarding the ETS. Since what about the effort sharing sectors? If we were to see much higher ambition, and especially a framework largely keeping the two kind of groups of sectors separate, what level price level would we expect to see in these sectors up to 2030? Any thoughts on this, Jakob?
Any thoughts? No answer. We did this study 2 years ago, 3 years ago, where we just used 100 euros per ton to buy an AA under the effort sharing. That was not so much because we thought the 2030 targets are so extremely ambitious that you need that price, but because we see that some member states are not acting or had not been acting fast enough. And this is a bit of a problem with the effort sharing. The sectors we have there, transport and the housing sector, you cannot just reduce emissions quickly. It's more gradual process because you have many houses you need to touch. Exchanging car stock takes a decade or two. So it's a process that needs to start soon enough to achieve the 2030 target. And the old impact assessment for the 2030 targets had a CO2 cost of 40 euros per ton, both in the ETS and the effort sharing. So much lower than the 100 euros we used to estimate the cost of AA. But the costs depend then more on the market situation. How much offer is there and how much demand is there? And so the crucial question is probably more, what will be the action on the UN national level to reduce emissions quickly? And then what are the costs of these measures? And not so much, what is the price in an AA market? Because this market is only semi-market. You only have a few large state actors. And it's not driven by actually a marginal cost to reduce emissions, but by other market constraints. So no, I don't have an estimate what the price would be. Sorry.
Thank you, Jakob. And if you did have the price, you would probably be doing a different job selling your advice. So, Patrick, now looking at especially, I think the graphic where you showed the column. Building with the different sectors and all of the different legislative items that are potentially under review and under discussion. I was wondering if you could comment on a question regarding how ambitious this legislative package that you evoke could be, and whether it's realistic that, as the Commission has foreseen, we would have a proposal on these legislative measures by mid-2021. That's the first question. And then if we do have one in that time frame, when would you see these negotiations being concluded? So what is the time frame for the policy discussion here as you see it?
Yes, well, I do think the Commission is committed to put the proposals by summer 2021 on the table. And actually, I think that will happen not all at once, but parts of it will already come within the next months. So the renovation wave will be presented this fall. I guess there will also be discussions on the agricultural policy already beforehand. So I expect that over the next 12 months, we see a number of proposals coming out of the Commission, with then probably in summer next year, a few big ones in a package that will include the ETS reform. It might also include the CO2 cars ordinance. And then take 2 years of negotiations between member states and parliament. So then we are basically in summer 2023. I would expect that it is under this commission and this parliament who will decide. So some last things may end up end of 2023. So then things can be in place when they are directly put into law, like the CO2 cars ordinance that could then take effect as of January 2024. With the ETS, it's then mostly 12 or 18 months implementation time for the national member states to put that into legislation. So if you really do all the accounting, you end up with, I guess, a new ETS starting in January 2025, which then also answers part of Felix's questions. The 2023 option is probably not really there if you look at the process. But that's then another reinforcement why the rebasing is so important, because the rebasing in combination with 2025 linear reduction factor would also lead to very good results when it comes to carbon emission reductions.
Thank you, Patrick. I'm not sure if we can answer this question, but I thought I would, since it has been posed, ask this question to Jakob or Felix, whoever can provide an answer. Have we actually in the study provided an answer as to what the total emissions reductions by 2030 would be if we stretched both sectoral reductions to the limits that we prescribed in this study?
I think we have these on slide 5 of the presentation. We did an analysis of the existing scenario analysis, and we did an update for the vision scenario, which is for the time being the most aggressive emission reduction scenario, where we have explained emission trajectories bottom up, and then this from this perspective, I think if we would stretch the ETS to the limits, we will probably end somewhere around 63%, and for the ESR we would probably end with the 49. So we would end with total emission reductions which are somewhere on the way to 60, but this would be probably the ultimate stretching of the potentials if we stay in the normal modernization cycles, etc., etc. Although one needs to say that even in the vision scenario, we have done a lot of emission reduction, which goes beyond the normal modernization of the capital stocks, but it's not going much beyond the 63% for the ETS, and it's not going to be much more than the 49% for the sectors that are regulated by the effort sharing regulation.
Thank you. And Jakob, another question here that was already responded to in writing at the beginning of the webinar. With regards to the national allocations, as we've seen them so far, you described them as largely being based on per capita GDP, and there was a question from the audience whether this was a pure GDP-based allocation method or whether any other aspects were taken into consideration in these calculations of the targets, and maybe you can comment on how exactly those were determined and any kind of non-pure GDP considerations.
Yes. So the basic approach to distribute the effort sharing targets has been GDP per capita. And then you have a line of all the member states according to the GDP per capita, and the target goes up. This is the basic mechanism. But on top of that, there have been obviously deals in the council, which we only see the results, but also considerations of cost effectiveness. And this for the 2030 targets was based on the PRIMES modeling for 2030, which came up with a cost-effective potential for countries which had an effort-sharing target above the EU average and a cost-effective potential below, a lower cost-effective potential. Their target was modified by a few percentage points. And I would assume that any proposal that comes based on GDP will also then be changed somewhat, but these changes have always been small compared to the GDP per capita as the basis of this distribution.
Thank you. And I would actually pose the next question to you again, Jakob. Susanne Illerding has asked the question as to how high the chances are of a project-based mechanism in Europe For example, in the form of a renovation wave in Eastern Europe financed by member states like Germany in the context of some kind of European-based project-based mechanism. Any thoughts on this?
Yes. This is possible. This kind of project mechanism is possible both under Renewable Energies Directive as well as under the ETS, as well as under the effort sharing. All three include a provision that allows member states to achieve their domestic targets or their national targets, including through such kind of mechanisms. It is not operational in the ETS. It's not operational in the effort sharing at the moment. In the effort sharing, there are two ways. You can either go through Article 24 of the ETS regulation, which would require guidance and decisions on the EU level, but you can, member states could also do this bilaterally. There's no one stopping Germany and Bulgaria to decide such a project mechanism now, and then they do it together, and then there's some kind of transferring of AAs from Bulgaria to Germany. So this is more a question of willingness and less of whether this is possible or allowed. I know that some countries like Denmark have been exploring this option quite a bit, at least in the discussions. So it might come, but again, if we're talking about the buildings and the transport sector where these projects will most likely need to be, this needs to happen soon to have significant reductions until 2030. If you start a buildings project in 2028, then the impact in 2030 will be very small.
Thank you.
Maybe just to add on that, to be honest, I'm skeptical when it comes to all those project-based mechanisms because in essence, it would mean Bulgaria or Romania hand over their emission reduction potential to other member states. And they need their emission reductions themselves. They'll have an emission reduction a target under the ESR that is also challenging for them. So I think issues like the renovation wave are solidarity mechanisms where money is raised and given to those member states with below average GDP to fulfill their targets and not to reduce emissions so that the rich ones can fulfill their targets.
Thank you, Patrick, for those additional thoughts. And I would have started with you on this next question, but now I direct it at Felix. And the question is regarding the ETS and its impact on the power sector. I will just paraphrase to ask, when we look at ETS revision at the scale that you discussed in your presentation, what impact would this have on remaining lignite and hard coal production in Europe, and what would it mean for the ability of renewables to finance themselves in the market?
These are two different questions. The first question is pretty clear. If you go to 60 or 61% emission reduction below the 2005 levels, this means that almost coal needs to leave the system around 2030. So this is very clear. And the other answer is that there is probably a share of 20% which is left for natural gas, and that means it is about the rollout of renewables. The CO2 price might play a role, but in these high share renewable worlds, you need to be very clear that the key revenues for renewables would occur in hours when the wind blows and the sun is shining. And at these levels we are discussing for 2030 on, always if the wind is blowing, or most of the time when the wind is blowing and the sun is shining, the price will be zero. Whatever the CO2 price is, and that means the CO2 price might support the rollout of the renewables, but at the end of the day, this will depend essentially from companion mechanisms, market design support mechanisms, whatever it is, to roll out the renewables. And I think this is very clear and that's one of the reasons we thought we need to have a very rigorous look on the policy mix, because beyond the power sector, a 40% emission reduction in industry will, for example, require significant efforts in the steel industry and also in the chemical industry. In other words, we will need to see certain amounts of hydrogen in the system. And there's no way to push by 2030 significant quantities of hydrogen to the system alone based on the incentives from the CO2 price. And therefore, this even the 61% will have a major impact on the CO2 price, which will primarily solve the competition among the fossil fuels. In other words, the coal phase out. For other segments of the emission reduction and the segments which are regulated by the EU ETS, the carbon price will help. But the final and the ultimate trigger for these emission reductions will also result from the companion policies, hydrogen, market design, however you name these. And this make this that's the reason why it is so important to have a very frank debate what the appropriate policy mix is that we go for these level of emission reductions.
Patrick, do you have anything to add?
No, I mean, I totally agree with what Felix has said, and maybe can take up the question here that is on the Commission's strategy on green hydro and offshore, which basically directly comes from Felix's answer. So, yes, I think the Commission strategy on green hydrogen is the right one, because we will need hydrogen to decarbonize industry, energy-intensive industry. They need hydrogen, and that means more renewables, wind offshore in the north, more wind and solar in Spain and Italy and Greece, and then a hydrogen network throughout Europe. And the ETS alone won't deliver that. So the key issue with the hydrogen strategy will be, so what is the instrument that really gets those investments done? And that's not answered yet. There the Commission strategy is silent. And I think that's one of the key elements of a policy package to be presented next year. How do we get the high shares of renewables that are needed in a minus 55% world? And how do we get the hydrogen electrolysis to really get the hydrogen?
Thank you. I have two more questions I would ask before giving you an opportunity to provide final comments. So the first question would be, is a relatively straightforward one, but either to Felix or Jakob, rebasing. How exactly would rebasing be implemented in practice? I think for some people this is a new concept. It might seem straightforward, but just maybe explain to us how straightforward it is then. What exactly would you do in legislation to make rebasing work?
It's pretty simple. If you go for rebasing, you have a one or two or three step reduction of the auctioning volumes. That means if you go for a rebasing of 150 million tons, then you reduce the auctioning volumes maybe in three subsequent years. Always about 50 million allowances. So that means you take out number one, the base level, in 1 year, and then you base the linear reduction factor on this new level, and then you are on the new trajectory. You can do this once, or you can distribute this, but essentially you reduce the annual auction volume by the level of rebasing. Again, there are many ways to do this, but it is simply that we do this on a regular basis with the MSR. We did this with the backloading, that we reduce the annual auctioning volumes to get on a new trajectory.
Thank you. And then a final question, which I think is a difficult one to answer, but it relates to the ETS as an income source or revenue source, and maybe the use of those revenues via the EU budget. So currently we have the situation where some of the allowances in the ETS are auctioned for the Innovation Fund and Modernization Fund and are distributed as part of an innovation and solidarity policy. We also have a conversation currently about own resources with regards to potentially a new carbon border adjustment mechanism that could feed into helping to finance the EU budget. The question here from the audience was essentially, would it support reaching the new targets in TS if more auction money would go directly into the EU budget and be redistributed by the EU? Or is it perhaps politically more difficult than a benefit? So that would be the way how I pose this question. I think it's to either Patrick or Felix, whoever wants to answer this question.
Yeah, maybe that is a good point to come back to the solidarity issue, because implementing this higher target, obviously, given that Eastern Europe is skeptical, will need solidarity mechanisms, especially for the East and also Southern Europe. And in essence, the effort sharing and ETS allowances are an option for that. So we could have that innovation fund a lot bigger than we have it today. The innovation fund would then maybe have dedicated money going to in certain member states in order to help them do just transition or other basically investments in those regions where the coal phase out is taking place. Same can be thought with effort sharing, that basically a part of the effort sharing allowances are auctioned off, and that is then a financing tool for the renovation wave. I think just putting it into the EU's budget won't work. It has to be dedicated for climate projects in countries that have below average GDP.
I think if I could add something, I think there are essentially three different questions. The first is the political question, and from the political perspective or the political economy, redistribution will be play a much bigger role in the ESR and in the ETS. Because if you really go to climate neutrality by 2050, there's only little space for flexibility and emission trajectories, and that means you need to compensate hardships somewhere with money. I think this is, and there the redistribution element will increase significantly in this decade of the 2020s, which is decisive for in the end of the day for climate neutrality by 2050. The second is from a pure climate perspective. It doesn't matter if the things are going through the EU budget or national budget, if the right things are done. And so this is important, and that will probably differ in different fields of actions. The third and most painful debate will be how much money will be there for this, for redistribution. And I think if you really go for this ETS perspective, and if you assume that policymakers and decision makers would get the idea that you would like to maintain the recent level of free allocation to the industry, then in 2030, only a small part of the auctioning revenues would be left. And therefore, it is important to talk about the policy mix, and their border adjustments will play a role. What is the key mechanism for compensating or avoiding carbon leakage will be an important point also for the question which quantities of money are available for redistribution. Because if we stay with free allocation as the main carbon leakage protection mechanism, then the auctioning revenues will decrease very quickly. And if the auctioning revenues would decrease very quickly, the millions or the billions which are available for redistribution and also for things like compensation of indirect CO2 costs will be narrowed down significantly. And again, this is one of the points that we need to have an enlightened debate, not only on the cap, but also on the interference between carbon leakage protection mechanisms, the future auctioning volumes, and then what part of these auctioning volumes will be available for redistribution. And we should never forget in the debate on 2030 that the ultimate target is 2050 carbon climate neutrality. And that means that the range of intertemporal flexibilities is extremely limited. This needs to be a part of the bigger of the bigger package and the bigger debate on the ETS in the policy mix of the European Union, be it EU-wide, be it in a coalition of the progressive, or be it on the national member states level.
Thank you. And since we are now very close to the hour, I believe I will skip final remarks, because I thought both of those last comments were quite appropriate and a lot of food for thought for the end of this webinar. And I will hand over to Nicola to just help guide us out of this webinar. Thank you for joining.
Thank you for on the podium, and also the audience, which not everyone continued till the end, but we still almost have 100 participants. I think this leaves us all with a lot of food for thought. Of course, if you have any questions or remarks that are coming up later afterwards, after you've sort of digested all what you just heard and saw, send us an email to webinar@agora-energiewende.de, and I will forward it accordingly. You can find the slides on our website. I just published the link to it once more. And the recording of this webinar will be online either tomorrow or Monday, I should think. Everyone who's on our recipients list of our newsletter will usually be informed, and also everyone who attended, I do send an email. But if you're very curious and want to have it first, then visit our events section of the website and you can find it there. We will have more events next week. Well, one next Tuesday on the 15th is going to be about modernizing the European lignite triangle, implications of a coordinated lignite phase out by 2032. I was listening to 2030 all the time, so I thought I got that incorrect, but I think it's right. 2032 in Germany, Poland, and the Czech Republic. Patrick will be on the podium again, together with Joanna Makowiak-Pandera, the president of our sister organization, Forum Energy. That's going to take place next week, Tuesday. I believe it's 10 o'clock. Check our website. And we'll have more online events to come. The easiest to be kept up to date is to subscribe to our newsletter. And with this, I leave everyone into the late afternoon for another coffee or a cake or what have you. We'll be sitting on the podium for another few minutes and see you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye. See you next time.